This episode of Living in Las Vegas is brought to you by The Capital Grille.
Yummy.
It's Barbara Sotonis in Salem, Wisconsin, welcoming you to the Living in Las Vegas podcast on the Vegas Video Network.
Hot new duo, Barb and Scott, touring the world. Nicely done, Barb. Las Vegas starts now. Why, yes, it does. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome from Las Vegas, Nevada, that groovy little podcast that gives you a true first-person look into what it's like to call Sin City your home, the Living in Las Vegas podcast.
Here we go.
And now your host,
yes.
A man who clearly needs some kind of introduction, otherwise you wouldn't know who he was.
Sing it, Brother Scotty.
Mr. Scott Whitney. Welcome, everybody, to the Living in Las Vegas podcast here on the Vegas Video Network. Very nice. And allow me to be the first to congratulate, because you're watching or listening to the longest-running podcast about Las Vegas that actually originates from Vegas. That's right. So we're not only going to be talking about adventures here in Vegas town, but we're going to be talking about our trials and tribulations elsewhere on the Strip, downtown, Fremont Street, other cool places here on the in the Valley. And by the way, if you're a fan, if you're a tourist, or maybe you're just thinking about moving to Las Vegas, well, guess what? This show is like your own secret handshake to all things cool and groovy. Hey, we're live every Tuesday at 7 p.m. Pacific time at VegasVideoNetwork.com/live. Again, VegasVideoNetwork.com/live. Come on over. Christina Aguilera said it best. Come on over. Come on over, baby. We've got the coolest people in the whole interweb in our live chat. Here's what you're going to do. You're going to join us. Why? Because it's fun. So you get to be a part of the fun. You like the show. You get to be a part of the show. And you get in the live chat and you hang out with some of the prettiest people you're ever going to meet. Now, I've got people showing up an hour before the show hanging out. Why? Electronic kumbaya between each other. Their own little town here. They're very, very loving and caring. And I really love them a lot. And they're all over the place. I've got people in the Vegas. I've got people in the Hendertucky. I got them in Arizona, Illinois, California, Alabama, Michigan, Florida, Texas. I got even people from the Connecticut, Canada. They are everywhere. But here's the magic of being here in the live show. We do a little pre-show. You get to see how we kind of put this sausage together. But then the real magic comes post-show. Once we're done recording, we stay on for another half hour. And we talk about things that we can't talk about in the regular show. And I promise one of those will be coming up in this post-show. Hey, I'm your host, Scott Whitney. Hi. Konnichiwa. Buenas noches. How you doing, hot stuff? I am the owner and founder of the Vegas Video Network. So first, on behalf of this show, thanks for watching. And on behalf of all the shows on the Vegas Video Network, thanks for supporting all of us. Hey, we've got, a quick over and under, 62 and a half. We've got some new live chat people, quite a few, actually. First, we've got Jake the Rake, 1949. Now, Jake the Rake has actually been in the live chat a few times. We just didn't talk about him. Who is Jake the Rake? Well, it's Jack and Terry. They're from British Columbia. We have a big following in Canada. We're planning on doing a tour, and we're just going to go to British Columbia. That's the plan. Or maybe Toronto, and I'll explain why. They found us through an underground porn ring featuring slightly overweight middle-aged men. So I appreciate that. Thank you, Jack and Terry, for digging this vibe. Also new in the live chat, we've got Jen Eric MN from Minnesota. It's Eric and Jen. They've been watching us for about a year and a half now, discovered us on the YouTube. We get a lot of new viewers from the YouTube. And also just joining us, just saw him before we started, Dan the Bear from Toronto. I'm not sure how Dan found us, but given his name, it might also been in the underground porn ring featuring slightly middle-aged men. Oh, found us on YouTube. YouTube. Sure you did, pal. Also, thanks to Barb in Wisconsin for that lovely rendition of, Peace on Earth? It was the, David Bowie / Bing Crosby version, where she was playing the David Bowie part, as I recall. All right, let's get this party started. Well, today we're going to talk about the five mistakes Las Vegas has made in 2016. Now, listen, this is the season to look back and review and think about this year, the 2016. Quite frankly, I thought 2016 was a pretty shitty year. I had friends die. I had a dog die. I had celebrities die. Fuck it. This is not a great year. But even throwing that away, I think Las Vegas, quite frankly, zigged where they should have zagged. And I saw an article today that made me think, I've got to talk about this. There's a few things that are kind of, gnawing at me that I just want to get off my chest. This is kind of like therapy. So instead of paying you guys $2.50 an hour, I appreciate you guys hanging out and listening to me rant. So, top five things that Las Vegas made mistakes on or screwed up. Number one, paid parking on the Strip. What? That's never been talked about on the show. Well, it's deeper than just charging somebody $10. Here's the issue. This again, and I've said this many times, this is an example of Las Vegas losing its cool. And what I mean by that is it's two ways. Cool as in hipness. You're losing your hipness, Vegas. And also, they become this stress-based response center where they're panicking every turn and they're starting to do dumb shit things that make them not cool and not a fun place. So if you look at what this represents, though, I think it's a much deeper thing than just saying, give us your money. I think this represents a major failure to produce a product that meets the casino's monetary goals. So they have this product out there, and they've put it out there for lots and lots of years, and it's no longer winning. And what it means is they are failing to provide a product that matters anymore. Now, if we look back 10 years or 20 years or hell, 30 years, there was no resort fees and there were no parking fees. And this town was killing it, man. Just killing it. We had a three-tiered product that made a shitload of money, right? We had gaming. Ching, ching. Oh, I should have my effect there. Hold on. We had gaming. Oh, fuck. See, the Russians took away my sound effect. We had gaming. We had food and beverage. And we had entertainment, the trifecta of joy for adults. We had it all. And it was working. Now, and people were happy to pay. They're like, let's go to Vegas. Let's pay this. I'm happy. This place is cool and groovy. It's happened. Yeah, it was cool and groovy. Now, 9/11 certainly slowed things down. There's no arguing that. But that was 14 years ago. We have recovered from that incident. But if you come back again to parking fees, it's a failure to do their job. Yes, Scott, but wait a minute. Other hotels charge for parking? Exactly! We were positioned as an escape from other hotels, from people's regular lives. Other hotels charge for parking. We don't do that nonsense because we're fucking cool. This is what we do. Nope, that's not what we do anymore. So but wait a minute. What was the other argument? Oh yeah, we have low room taxes, and it's okay to start charging against that. Now, no, we have low room taxes because we have gaming. The hotels in, I don't know, Newport Beach don't have gaming. That's why we could do that. That's why we were cool. That was the power we had. And we fucking just lost our mind. So now, well, I don't even talk about the stadium yet. We'll do it. So what's going on? Now, some people will say to me, yeah, Scott, we heard about this and everybody was, oh, yeah, we're going to boycott. And more comments than ever before were on the Review Journal website. I'm never going to MGM Grand. And guess what? People still went to MGM Grand and people are still coming to Vegas. You're full of shit, Scott. This will make no difference. Well, you might be right. 42 plus million people have come here in 2016, and it's been trending up the last couple years. Probably going to be more. By the way, MGM did this. All sounded pretty scary. They made a shitload of money doing this. I think in the millions of dollars they made from just parking. So they took a lot of heat from this, but they ended up making a boatload of money. So guess what? All the other properties had no choice. This is business 101. These guys are sitting back going, well, first we're going to let MGM take the heat. God bless their little hearts. Wait a minute. People are still going to MGM properties and they're paying that money and they just announced that they made millions and millions of dollars. You know what, Dave? What's that, Jim? We're leaving money on the table and that's not a feature. And I don't know if you know how us casinos like to work, but we like to make money, not give it to the fucking competition. So let's go ahead and charge for parking as well. And they're doing that. The Cosmopolitan quote was fascinating. So Cosmopolitan was the most recent guys to say, yeah, fuck, we're charging for parking. What are we going to do? And they basically said this. We've got this property, a single property, and the smallest amount of parking we are allowed to have legally. 3,000 or so parking spots, whatever the number. And what was happening is people probably going to City Center, ARIA or whatever, were parking in our place, but they weren't coming in our property. So we were subsidizing our competitors. What the fuck are we supposed to do? Of course they're going to charge for parking. And they said it. We're only charging for parking to get people to stop parking here. Oh, good Lord. So here's my thinking. I think this ancillary charge nonsense is complete bullshit. I think it's fraudulent, personally, but I'm a little paranoid about that. But I think all of these things should be completely upfront. Resort fees, you should see them as part of the charge when you see the room. It shouldn't be an add-on. Shouldn't be that hidden $32 or $35 or whatever nonsense is. Parking fees should be part of the goddamn thing so you know what's going on. City fees, now that's not happening here in Las Vegas, but like Newport Beach, I mentioned Newport Beach. Newport Beach charges a city fee to be there. I should see that when I book the fucking room. And basically, all fees. This is nonsense. All right. That's my first one. How am I doing? 15 minutes and I'm already angry. By the way, hot buttered rum, everybody. I'll give you my recipe a little bit later. The number two thing that I think is ridiculous here in Las Vegas in 2016, and that is squatters. Squatters? What's a squatter, Scott? Imagine this. Imagine this. A man leaves his home on vacation. He travels for a while and comes back and finds other people in his home and he can't get them out. Sounds crazy? He's in the Twilight Zone or fucking Vegas. This is happening. I'm going to read you some content from an article I saw on the Review Journal. It talks about squatters and particularly about this new bill, the AB 386, going into effect in October 1st, establishing criminal offenses of housebreaking, unlawful entry, and unlawful reentry as they pertain to squatters. By the way, you're probably thinking squatters, oh yeah, they're probably in abandoned homes, of which there are several in Las Vegas. Well, I kind of get that. No. First of all, no, you don't get that. That's bullshit. But it's people whose home, they leave and they come back and there's somebody in their fucking house. What's going on? Okay. So, combating squatters was difficult for law enforcement. What? How could that be difficult? Get the fuck out of the house. Oh my God. The new law basically creates two new crimes, housebreaking and unlawful occupancy, making it a criminal offense for squatters to re-enter a home after they've been removed. Before the new law, the eviction process could take, wait for it, months. But now it only takes days, says Scott Birdie from the Greater Las Vegas Association of Realtors. In order to get a squatter out, one of two scenarios has to happen. The homeowner can call the police, report a squatter, and wait for the police to arrest everyone in the house before changing the locks. Ching, ching. Then the owner has to post a notice of retaking possession, a legal document obtained in the court, on the property for 21 days. I'm repossessing my own home, but I've got to put up a document for 21 days. You've got to be shitting me. During that time, the squatters can file to the court saying, hey, we'd like a hearing to return to the property. Welcome to the Wild West. If the squatter doesn't request a hearing, well, good news. The lockout happens and the homeowner has to keep the squatter's, well, kind of good news, but the homeowner has to keep the squatter's belongings safe for 21 days, either inside a storage unit at the expense of the squatter. See, we're thinking on our feet there, or inside the house. After 21 days, the homeowner can throw out or donate all the items. Another obstacle to removing a squatter, if a squatter claims something is missing from his belongings. This fucker got into your house, left an iPad there. Nah, probably not an iPad. Left a, I don't know. Well, it might be an iOS device. And he could claim it was lost or missing, like a watch for a few dollars. The homeowner can be taken to court, further delaying the eviction process. That's fantastic, isn't it? Oh, here's the second scenario, is if the police, they don't want to get involved. It forces the homeowner to give the squatter a four-day notice to surrender. Yeah, there's no potential conflict there. No chance for violence there. Whoever serves it has to go to the property, and if the squatter is there, they have to sign for it. Yeah, good luck with that. If no one is there, they have to mail it to or post it on the property. So I have to mail it to my own house, hoping that the squatter collects his mail and checks things out. Is this unbelievable? The squatter has 4 days, business days, to leave the home or file a response with the Las Vegas Justice Court asking the judge not to lock them out by claiming they are the legitimate tenants, which also delay the process by about a week. Isn't this, this goes on, but holy Christ almighty. This is when you want Mike in the live chat to be your co-homeowner, right? What's that law? The manager castle law or whatever it's called. Yeah, I think Mike's response would be, my God, I believe there's people in my house. Excuse me. I'm going to go out to my garage there and get some. Squatter be gone. Brought to you by Mike. Oh, Mike's looking for a job in Las Vegas. I've got it. The castle doctrine. Mike's new job is Squatter Be Gone, squatterbegone.com, where we ensure no squatters will live at your home. Thank you. You'll be here all week. Okay. Number three, things that Vegas have done wrong in 2016. This is also done wrong in 2015, 2014, 13, 12, 11, 10, my recollection's at least till 10, and that is professionalism. Business professionalism. Now, this is an ongoing pet peeve of mine, but there is no question that professionalism in Las Vegas as a practice is a joke. It's just not in the game. 2000 is no different. 2016 is no different than what I've experienced before. For 2016, I got to deal with another fucking con man. How great is that? Yeah, the guy says he wants to join the co-op. He does. He makes his first payment. He comes in. We shoot some videos. He signs to do some more stuff. Beyond the first thing, I come in. I help him tell his fucking story. And then the next payment comes in, a credit card decline. Hey, dude. Oh, yeah. I lost the credit card. Hey, dude. Yeah. I'm just waiting for the credit card. Hey, dude. Yeah, I think I'm. Hey, dude. I ain't paying you. What? What? How'd that happen? Yeah, I'm not going to use it. I'm not paying you. Dude, that's not the fucking agreement. Come to find out after a little sniffing around, this guy didn't have one business. He had 14 businesses, some fucking P.O. box over on Eastern Avenue. Oh, my God. Now, Is there any chance there are bad people outside of Vegas? Well, of course there are. But I didn't see it. The kind of behavior that I've seen here, and not, by the way, not just con men behavior, but people who can't pay their bills, have no idea how their business would actually work, just regular behavior in meetings, or people who are given titles that have no business having that title. I've seen all of that here over and over again. It's embarrassing. You just got to go, okay, how is this happening? Well, my guess is that it's a reflection on the transient nature that is Vegas. You know that talk, our tagline used to be 5,000 people moving here a month. That's true. But a number of people were moving out here as well because they just couldn't get it done. You know, the con didn't work for so long. It's just a bunch of bullshit. I think that transient nature, and I think Vegas in general, tends to attract, you know, low lives. And that's a shame. Now, it's not everybody, of course. I happen to know a handful of people, literally a handful of people, who I think, you know what, these guys are good business people. Fortunately, one of them works next door to me now. He's a friend. We had him on the show, Doug Geinzer. Good guy. Does good stuff. Works hard. You know, smart. Fuck, he's a good guy. But I'm telling you, he is an exception to the rule. And this also, you know, it's not just the business guys, it's the entertainment world here as well. I'm beginning to get more and more fed up with the entertainment business here. I mean, it's, you know, going to the show is great. And there is a handful of people who are, you know, like, this guy is probably okay. But true story. Well, let me see. Nope. I will tell you the story in the post show about an entertainer who was supposed to be on the show tonight, but he did some stuff that I thought was just fucking incredible. And I couldn't believe what he was saying. I said, that's not going to happen. I'll talk about it in the post show. Number four, politics, or specifically politicians. When I moved to Las Vegas, when Melissa and I moved here, we moved here in 2005. And it was odd to us that a lot of the politicians here in the Vegas area were either on trial or going to jail or in jail. We thought that was unique. Now, we thought, well, you know, although it's surreal, you know, it is Las Vegas. It is kind of the Wild West. And back in 2005, it felt like the Wild West for us. I mean, when we first moved here, we had a pool built, and they included a 200-gallon-a-day leak underneath our deck. That was free, by the way. We found a landscaper. We gave him an $1,800 deposit. He thought that was a gift and booked. Now, we got both of our stuff situated on both of those. But it was just like, what? This is craziness going. All these politicians are going to jail. What is happening? Clearly, it's a reflection of the professionalism, as we talked about in the previous point. What is going on here? But here's the deal. The job of a politician is to do what their constituency asks them to do. That's their job. Period. And the most recent example of them ignoring the people who put them into office is the Raiders deal. And I've ranted about this before, and here's the deal. The majority of people in Clark County and Las Vegas said, we do not want this deal. It's not right. Don't do it. And they completely ignored it and voted it through. Now, there is no way that these politicians voted this through because of the business case. It can't happen. Nobody is that dumb. Here's the example. Here's the actual business case. I'm going to talk to you like we're going to do a deal. Okay, here's what I've got. I've got a fantastic idea for a business idea. It's very shiny and very pretty, and it's going to make us a lot of money. Right? Good. Okay, here's what's going to happen. We're going to have three partners in it. Well, three people are going to invest. We'll call them investors, not partners. Sorry, slip. You'll be investor one. You're going to put 40% in. Okay, sounds good. I'm going to put 30% in, and investor C will put in 30. So 40, 30, 30. That sound good? Fantastic. Now, I'm sorry, what? Oh, what's the payback? That's a silly question, politician guy. But I'll answer it because, you know, people are going to want to know. You get nothing. Bupkis. Shit. You get nothing. Ever. No way. Oh, what do I get? Reasonable question. I've always liked that about you. I get, well, I don't want to put a cap on it. As a matter of fact, I'm going to put that in writing. There is no cap on my revenue win from this. That seem fair to you? Yes? Okay. Meanwhile, the boys, the 30-30s are fighting, by the way. That's great. Adelson wants to own some of the NFL. He wants to own a little bit of that Raiders thing. So a little fighting among the girls. But here's what I'm hoping. I hope it's not me saying I told you so in 2017. You know, we'll see. I want all things to work well for this city, but come on, goddammit. If the people who elected you, if your constituency says don't do it, fuck, don't do it. Just, you know, follow what people are asking you to do. You are supposed to represent them, for the love of God. Do it. Okay. Oh, I do want to say one more thing about politicians. You know, why are politicians like that? And I think it's because insane people run for politics. Right? I have talked to a couple people who I thought would be good legislators, who would do good things. And I've had a couple people, you know, a number of people say, you know, you should run for office. And here's why all of us say no. Fuck that. The scrutiny, the background checks, the mud, the dirt, the best people in this country to run the country don't want anything to do with it. They may be doing stuff in the background, but holy crap, there is no way that, you know, really great people want to run for politics. It just seems odd. So I think the people who run aren't the best people in the world. Now, if I did run for politics, if I did run, here's my platform. Ready? If you are a hacker and you put a virus on my computer or ransomware, that's a felony. You're going to jail for 20 years. Do not fuck with my economy. Do not fuck with my country's economy. That's bullshit. And even if you're just making it so I can't use Instagram, fuck you. You're going to jail for 20 years and you're going to be the bitch in the B block. Done. Next one. As I said before, no hidden fees. If you buy something, you should know what the goddamn cost is up front. If I buy something and then I realize, holy shit, I didn't see this. I got to pay for that. Fuck that. Have the balls to say what I charge is what I charge. If somebody goes to the co-op or somebody wants to be on the network or somebody hires Podworks, I don't go, yeah, I'm going to charge you this for the live stream. Oh, I'm sorry. Did you actually want people to see it? Oh, I'm sorry. We charge just a bit more for that. So that's my platform, Scott Whitney, 2020. Okay. And number five, things that we have made mistakes on in Las Vegas. Homicide. When checked in April of this year, 2016, compared to April of last year, 2015, the murder rate went up 100%. 100%. It's gone up since 2012. There was this downward trend until 2011, and then all of a sudden it started climbing back up again. Las Vegas Metro Police Department have a chilling report on their website. First time I've ever seen it was today when I was researching this topic. And they have for every year, I think it's 2013, 14, 15, and 16 to date, a PDF file that lists every victim who was murdered and where they were killed. The date, the time, the day, the location, the person's name, and whether their kinfolk have been contacted. In 2016, 164 murders. The fuck is happening? What in the hell is going on here? What are we doing? How does somebody think in a conflict? Listen, I've been angry at a lot of people, but I've never thought I want to end that person. But there are people running around today in this city and all over the place who think, Yeah, you know the best way to end this conflict? He stole my tennis shoes. I'm going to fucking kill him. What is that? You know, is that a parent's thing? You know, is it schooling? Is it parent education? I don't know. Now, when the police were asked about that, they said there's a direct connection between the number of murders and the number of cops on our streets, which makes sense to some extent. I mean, well, it makes sense. There's no question. And they're going to be adding another 300 police over the course of the next year, which is all fine and well and all that good stuff. But the problem is, A, they got to ramp up, and B, it's not hitting the core issue we're involved here. Having a bunch of police, creating a police state is not the answer. The answer is, what the fuck is the core reason that these people are shooting each other? What is going on here? What do we have to do to solve this problem? And we shouldn't be spending $750,000. Well, we're not spending $700 million on it. You are. The tourists are spending this money, not us. But wouldn't it be better to say, maybe we should figure out how to educate these fuckers so they're not shooting each other? Let's get him a job. There's a guy out there, I don't know if you know who he is, Mike Rowe. I met him in San Francisco. I did I was on a weight loss thing over the course of a year for an evening magazine thing, and it was with this gal, Malou, and he was the other host in there. And so I knew of him, and he's turned into become a kind of a big deal. Mike Rowe does this. He talks about the idea of education doesn't have to be college. You know, you don't have to go to college to be a successful adult. But I think a lot of people think that if you don't go to college, then you can't be successful. And I am proof that that's not true. I'm, you know, relatively successful. I didn't go to college. Went in the Air Force. And that was super helpful. I think a lot of people who have tough lives, I didn't have a particularly tough life, but, you know, I think a lot of people go in the military and it really turns them into men or women, adults. Did for me. I rapidly got my shit together when I was in the military. And that was pretty fantastic for me. I learned a lot of neat stuff. I learned how to deal with a lot of different people, rich, poor, white, black. Yeah, it didn't matter. You were forced to deal with that. And I thought that was pretty cool. And I think that's the problem with this high murder rate is these people feel lost. We got to figure out, what do we do? How can we get these people jobs? Like, make them a living. They can be proud of themselves, and they can go out and do no harm and contribute to society. That's the, I don't have the fucking answer, but you know, I think that's the deal. And I'm hoping that something happens. I hope 2017 is a shitload better year than it was this year. I'm kind of hoping it is. Now in the live chat, we've got some people saying compulsory service for the military. Pops didn't go to college, built his own house, his own boat. He can build a houseboat, grow his own food. He's got his own company, I know. Yeah, I know a lot of folks who didn't do the straight college thing, did a military thing, and then, you know, ran the entrepreneur gamut, and it worked. Doesn't work for everybody, but, you know, for fuck's sake. I think that Ted's in there. I think everybody should have a year of military service. Yeah, I don't know that I feel that's the right move. I think what Israel does that, and a few other folks do that still, but yeah, so maybe. I haven't really given that much thought. I mean, it did a world of good for me. Just it quite frankly, it saved me. You know, I was not going to be in a good place if I hadn't done that. And it's, by the way, the homicide thing, I'm seeing this in the live chat as well. You know, you want to see homicide, go to Chicago. What in the hell? This is a top five city. I don't know how big it is, but this is a big boy city. Chicago is. And they're killing people like it's breathing air, for fuck's sake. Yeah, I don't get it. Let's, that's it. So here's hoping that 2017 is a better year. It's not all bad, of course. There's some pretty cool things as well, but this stuff just pissed me off. All right, let me hear from the people. Now is time for listening. if they could do that, they could make a living doing that. All right. Hey, this is brought to you by our good friends over at Capital Grill, our new sponsor. Again, my favorite restaurant in all of Las Vegas. Best steaks, best bartenders, best servers, real bartenders. I mean, real servers, by the way. People who are waiters. They're not actors bidding their time to try to get out there. It's a great location over at Fashion Show, third floor across from Wynn. Great view of the strip, arguably the view of the best sign, which is the Wynn sign, in all of Las Vegas. Been there for the last 2 years, New Year's Eve, and I'm going there again this year. So whether you're a tourist or a local, treat yourself to amazing dinner. Go hang out at the Capital Grill. Tell them that your buddy Scott suggested that you hang out there. All right. First question is from Ladady and Good Caesar Salads, according to Mike. The first question is from Mark Owen. Mark writes, Scott. Cheers from Atlanta. In the process of planning my next trip and looking for a good live music lounge. Plaza had one for a bit. Tuscany is constantly promoting their live music. And back when Silver Sevens was terrible, the bar had a stage with cheesy but fun acts almost nightly. Not looking for anything fancy, but a spot to have a drink and hear some music. Thanks, Mark. Mark Owen from 92.9, the Game Midday producer, co-host of College Football Thursday, Atlanta Braves in-game host. All right, thank you, Mark, for that. Here's the great thing about Las Vegas. It is arguably one of the greatest towns to see live music. Now, it's not live music like you would see in Austin, where you see a band at every bar, or Nashville. Same kind of vibe, right? And those are fantastic. This is different. They are in the casinos, but they're everywhere from top to bottom. So let's take a look at this real fast. So if we start at the Stratosphere, the 107 Lounge, they will sometimes have a jazz trio up there. Sometimes they do the DJ thing. But the jazz thing's pretty cool. It's a nice place to watch a little jazz. T.I. has Senior Frogs in the front of T.I. They screwed up the front of it, but they do have live music there. Mirage. They have a new bar in the middle that has a kind of a cool, hip, jazzy thing. Now, we have banned that bar because the service there was shit. But nonetheless, there is live music. As we continue down, Caesars, Cleopatra Bars. It used to be the Matt Goss room, and that was a pay-to-get-in place. He has left, and Matt has left the building. And so now they have a variety of different acts, including Chris Phillips. Zoe Bowie is playing there every Tuesday and Wednesday night. And a variety of, you know, pretty well known local bands are playing there every day now, I think. It's pretty cool. Let's see. Harrah's, the piano bar. I want to see Big Elvis. That's the place to see. Great dueling piano. Probably the best view for dueling pianos as well. It's right on the strip. You can turn around and look at the strip while you're playing Piano Man for the 400th time. Bellagio. Bellagio has, if you like jazz, or just, you know, straight piano, there's the piano bar right next to the check-in counter. And then if you go into the casino a little bit more, there's another small little bar. Really not, you know, Bellagio is a pretty classy place. Jazz trio kind of place, very hip. Paris has probably my favorite top 40 bar. And I forget the name of it, the name of the lounge. It's a little bar off the side. For a while they had it open, then they had it kind of blocked off so you couldn't see. And I forget if they've taken those walls down or not. But they tend to have the top 40 funk, disco-y kind of stuff. And they're usually really, really good bands. Tropicana Lounge has live music. And Mandalay Bay has usually some pretty good bands in their main lounge as well. That's on the strip, of course, downtown. A couple places that come to mind. Golden Nugget at the Rush Lounge. You know, a lot of people have, you know, kind of started at Rush Lounge and moved their way up. That's a good club. Small, intimate. And of course, if you just want to watch, you know, good bands, the Fremont Street Experience, hard to beat that. Three stages, First Street, Third Street, and Main Street. And they've got live music playing, Jesus, all the time. You can't not hear live music at nighttime. So this is a pretty fantastic town to check out live music. Okay, next up. Mike G. from Ixonia. And Mike writes, Scott, I had an interesting experience this morning. I was propositioned by a young woman at 6 a.m. in the casino at Casino Royale, located on the strip. Small place, easy to miss. I love the $1 Michelobes. Note that, by the way, you can get a $1 beer on the strip. I don't like the hookers in the casino. On a plus side, it's good that I know I've still got it. P.S. There is 8 inches of snow, and it's 6 degrees at home. I love Las Vegas. Mike G. from Exonia. I didn't ask a question, but I will say this. and I don't mean to burst your bubble. Mike, I like you. You're one of my favorite people. But you don't got it. What you have is two legs, a heartbeat, you're able to breathe, and you apparently had a wallet. Because the criteria for a hooker at 6 in the morning at Casino Royal, it's a low bar, brother. It's a very, very low bar. Now, if you're at, let's say Mandalay. Now, let's go with Encore or the Venetian, and you get propositioned by a hooker there. Okay, the bar is, it's not that much higher, quite frankly. Okay, it's a little bit higher. But, you know, you get the ego stroke. That's part of what they're playing on. Oh, look at me. The chicks dig me. Nope. The chicks dig your money, which isn't fair, but it's true. All right. Real quick stories. Again, thanks to Barb for her introduction. A musical introduction? Come on. That's great. Hey, if you want to send in a video, you don't have to be that clever or that talented. All you got to do is send in a video. Use your phone for the love of God. Do it in landscape mode, just like this. Portrait? No. Landscape? Yes. And say something like, hey, I'm Dave Smith from Effingham, Illinois, and you're watching the Living in Las Vegas podcast on the Vegas Video Network. You can say something funny or play some musical stuff as well. Either way, I'm happy. Remember, landscape. Okay. Gee, Scott, you've had a couple pauses during the show for a sip of a beverage. What, pray tell, are you drinking? Oh, good question. I drink this only during the holidays. Really? Is it special? Oh, yes. Is it magical? Mm-hmm. Does it make you happy? You have no idea how happy it makes me. Let me share with you my hot buttered rum recipe. Really? You're willing to do that? I am, because I like you people. Ready? Hot buttered rum. It's what I'm drinking right now. One more taste and make sure it's still good. Nothing wrong with that. Okay, here's what you're going to do. In a pot over a stove, 1 stick unsalted butter. Plunk. 2 cups light brown sugar. 1 teaspoon ground cinnamon. 1/2 teaspoon grated nutmeg. A pinch of ground cloves, and a pinch of salt. Now you're going to cook all that goo together, get it nice and bubbly until you've got a nice batter. And now normally what you'll do is you'll let that set, and then what you're going to do, but you don't have to wait if you don't want to, but I usually wait. And then you get 2 heaping tablespoons in a mug, like this, 2 heaping tablespoons. And then what I do is I kind of even all out. So it's just not heaping. It's kind of equally distributed in the bottom of the mug. And then I pour rum over it. How much rum? Rum to taste. I tend to put as much rum to cover the batter. So, about 1 inch-ish. And then you fill that with boiling water. Top it off with boiling water. Or you can microwave it for, a couple minutes or whatever works. Stir, stir, stir. Drink it. You'll thank me, I promise. It is the greatest holiday drink ever. Now, some people in the family don't care for it, Melissa. But we're not going to hold that against her. Fair enough? Okay. Why did I write, folks say... Oh, okay. I want to say something to the people who watch this. Specifically, there's a handful of folks. I've seen this happen a couple times, and I just want to say thanks. You guys are so cool. I've seen a couple times now where people have written that Tuesday is their favorite day of the week because of this show. And I just want to say I am so touched by that sentiment. Now, these folks are folks in the live chat, obviously, because... Oh, what kind of rum, Jimmy? Any kind of rum. I think I'm using Bacardi here. Don't use... No, Bacardi's fine. So these people, dark or light, whatever you want for the rum. So these folks are constantly saying this, and I just think it's the sweetest thing in the world to think that Tuesday, which is, you know, categorically a shit day, not as shit as Monday, but it's still shit. They think that this day is a nice day. So I really want to, you know, tell the folks who are watching this or listening to this that I appreciate that. Now, some people in the live chat are saying, oh, it's sad they know that they have empty lives. No, I'm lifting my viewers up. I'm lifting the people who listen to my show up. These people don't have empty lives. They're the best ever. So you guys know who you are. I really do appreciate it. We've got some things brewing in my head that we're looking at doing in 2017 that are going to be, I think, pretty cool. You know, shit, we'll see. But more on that as time goes on. A quick health update. I am having surgery this Friday. Fuck. Not looking forward to it. And so what is it? No big deal, he says. You probably have seen a lot of the shows I've done over the last year or so where I had that black armband on my my left arm. Well, what that was is it's basically tennis elbow. yes, the live chat is now complete. It's you know, the live chat, they're hot and cold. 1 minute, oh, Scott, you're lovely. Now, oh, yeah, he's getting moobs removed. Men boobs. That's mean-spirited and uncalled for. It may be true, but, you know, come on, goddamn it. Yeah, so tennis elbow, which is basically a muscle ligament thing at this corner thing, and it's all inflamed and fucked up. And I've had cortisone shots, and I've had that thing, and it's gotten better and got worse and got better and got worse and got better. Now it's really pretty bad. So Friday, I'm going under the knife to have that taken care of. I'm not sure if that's going to affect next Tuesday's show or not. I'll let you guys know as soon as I decide how mobile and ambulatory I am. I think it'll be all right, but I'm not exactly sure. But if you are a believer in good things, send me lovely thoughts. And LDH, who I also believe is new. God, we got a shitload of new people in the live chat today. Thank you. I appreciate that, LDH. Speaking of positive thoughts, Rosie, who's in the live chat. Everybody, we're going to do a collective bye, Rosie, because Rosie, God bless her little entrepreneur heart, has found herself a job. She's had enough of me. And she came in thinking, yeah, this Scott Whitney seems like a nice guy. Wrote a very lovely letter. Oh, I think you're fantastic. I've come to Vegas partly because of you. She was hanging out with me for a couple of months, and she's like, oh, fuck, what the hell's going on here? I got to get out of this shit show. I got to run. Okay, that's probably not it. What actually is happening is that Rosie has, I think, a certain connection with the, what's the category for this kind of thing? Events, not events, but, you know, not amusement so much. Like when she was in Philadelphia, she worked for the most fantasticest ever horror, haunted house ever. Ask her. And when she came out here, she worked over at Shenandoah for a while. And that's her passion. She really likes that. So she's working on, she's got a job over at the Adventure Dome. And so I wish her well. She was fantastic. She's a good gal. And it was fun working with her. And she's one of those guys or gals who, you know, she's, you know, very sweet and offered to still help if I needed help. How cool is that, right? And she's an example of somebody who took an entrepreneur move. She was... she did some consulting with the Adventure Dome, and that led to a full-time gig. So congratulations to Rosie on that. Of course, we can never talk again. And she gave me, I got the key back from her because I don't trust her. And by the way, Rosie, the security code has been removed. I don't trust you. Oh, she's in the live chat. Oh, hi, Rosie. Just kidding. Okay, chat questions real fast. Jimmy wants to know, hey, could you give some advice on New Year's Eve? Closing of the strip, fireworks, parties, any inside information? Well, my first advice is this. If you've never done New Year's Eve in Las Vegas, you should do it at least once. I think it's fantastic. I've done both a strip New Year's thing and a Fremont strip New Year's thing. I did the New Year or the Fremont, Jesus Christ. I did the Las Vegas Strip one before we moved here. We flew in, saw a couple comedians at, Planet Hollywood, before it was Planet Hollywood, and then walked out into shoulder-to-shoulder people on the strip. It was terrific. And we've done three times at Fremont Street. Actually, that's my favorite of the get out and mix up with the unwashed masses. Because it's a bit more controlled. You got to pay to get in, so it eliminates a bit of the riffraff, quite frankly. They usually have really good bands. Everybody's in a good mood. Everybody's dressed up. It's a bit warmer because of the canopy. So I really like that. Like I said, we've done it three times. So what's my advice? Go. Don't think you're going to be cruising around in your car anywhere. They close the strip from Russell all the way to Sahara. So Russell down by Mandalay Bay up to Sahara by Stratosphere SLS. So there's no cars up there or going up and down the strip. And I think that starts at 6 o'clock at night. And I think I'm not sure if it goes to 3 in the morning or 6 in the morning or what the deal is. You're not driving. Here's one of my favorite tips. Oh, I'm just going to give this real quickly, is do what I do. And that is now we eat at Capitol Grill. It's a great view. Parking is free and easy because we're eating at Capitol Grill. And then we roam out in the street after we're done eating and hang out. Now, we're going to do a show and then a dinner kind of thing. We're going to go see Baz. Over at Palazzo or Venetian, wherever it is. My tip is, if you haven't done the strip, do the strip at least once. Because it's fantastic. Fireworks are happening, I think, from 9 different buildings all around the strip. That's great on the strip. Not as impressive, obviously, in Fremont Street. They do have fireworks going off underneath the canopy and then a light show fireworks thing. It's not the same as the fireworks that are blasting out in the strip. But nonetheless, my favorite one, quite frankly, is Fremont Street. So I would absolutely do that. And basically, every bar is having a party. Every lounge is having a party. Every club is having a party. You're not going to want for something to do. Pops wants to know, is there going to be a show next week? Oh, and if so, do you have a plan? What was last year? Oh, was last year the Christmas thing? Yeah, we're not going to do that. Again, I'm not sure what we're going to do for next week if we're going to do a show. There will not be a show the last week of December. The network takes that week off. Okay, let's have a drink. Have a drink on me. Righty, it's time for Have a Drink on Me. It's part of the show where I show you a picture of a pub or a lounge or a speakeasy or a bar, and you guys send in answers, guesses as to what that bar is based upon 3 clues that I give you. And there are many chances to win a lovely prize. You can send in an answer. That's one chance. You can be the first person to send an answer. We'll give you another chance. If you're in the live chat and you send in an answer, that's right, we'll give you another chance. And if you send in a video entry, we'll give you another chance. That means there's 25 ways that you can win in just one episode. How fantastic is that? Now, what can you win? Well, let's have Pops explain that for you, shall we?
Let me tell you what you can win this week.
This week's Lucky Hat'em winner can choose any one of 3 amazing Scott Whitney guitar CDs: Crisp Acoustic 1, Crisp Acoustic 2, or Gajazzathon. Proudly displayed here by Bob, undisputed king of the video Hat'em entry. Or you can choose the comfortable and stylish Vegas Video Network visor like these lucky winners. Available in the standard black and sometimes in the rare, hard-to-find red. Popular with the ladies and the Russians. Or you can choose the premium prize package. The next time you're going to be in Vegas, you can arrange an evening of sophistication and class with the man himself, the guru of all things Vegas, Scott Whitney. Well, okay, at least drinks, laughs, and some priceless conversation.
Send your entry into Have a Drink at VegasVideoNetwork.com. VegasVideoNetwork.com.
Thank you, Pops. Good man, Charlie Brown. Now, there's some bonusy magical things that also happen if you find yourself a winner and you're smart enough to ask for one of these here Vegas Video Network visors. Here it is in cream. This is very much like the ear of Van Gogh. Hard to find, but if you find it, worth a lot of money. I'm guessing that's right. I don't know. If you get one of those visors And you put it on your noggin, and you know, adjust it, make sure it's not too high. Put it on your noggin, take a picture of that, you send it back to your buddy Scott. Man, some groovy things happen. Really, Scott? What happens? Well, you become a part of the galaxy of God.
There's Michael and Robert and Rosie, who has left me. No one loves me anymore. Michael G and Scott and Mickey and Bud and Alan and Aaron. There's more. They are new to Spook. I think that there is Bob and Bobcliff and Jackie, and there is Jen and Craig and Glenn and Jimmy and Rob. Soon I'll be in Hawaii with Ken. Aloha, Stuart and Christina, whose all babies are because of my music. And Jackie, there's Mike. There's Pops as well. There's Sammy and Carol and a dog. Ooh, and Chris, who's in my backyard still. And Red Stamp, your buddy Scott. There's Wayne, who will be back. And, of course, friend Brett.
Thank you very much. All right, we got 19 out of 19 correct answers for last week's Have a Drink on Me. Here is that picture. There it is. And the clues were Morimoto, Morimoto, and Morimoto over at the MGM. All right, let's see what we got. La-da-dee. The number one entry, first in, first correct, Monica Fagan. Way to go, Monica. Past winner known as Binky, one for the correct answer. Whoops.
Oh, look at that. One for the correct answer. You slippery bastard.
Sorry about that. One for the correct answer. One for being in the live chat. Way to go, Binky. And one for being numero uno. So before we do anything, Binky already has three entries. That's pretty fantastic. Way to go, Monica. And we continue. Kevin Whip from Canada. This is from last week. I missed his entry. He sent an entry for this week and said, hey, here's proof that I sent in for last week, you dumbass. What happened? Well, okay, easy, Canada. Jeez. So that's for last week. Robert C., also known as Robo68 Pittsburgh, and he gets uno for the correct answer. Mike Beatty, one for the correct answer. Steve Rhodes from the UK, a previous winner. Andy in New Hampshire, one for that. Gary Romberg, Mr. Testy. Kevin Whip for this week, getting it correct. Brent Barnes from Paradise, California. Isn't all of California paradise? No. All right. Mike Gerzerwisky. I always mispronounce that. I always feel bad about that. I think he's one from Exonia. Yeah.
No. Yeah.
Previous on-air cue question. There you go, Mike. Boink. And we continue our joy. Steve I, the wise guy. One for the correct answer and one for being in the live chat. Hey, Steve. Good to see you, my brother. I can't see you, see. I don't have like a Russian camera spy thing going. Eric Norberg from Crystal, Minnesota. Oh, I think this is Eric. Jen and Eric. Yeah, sure. Eric Norberg. One for the correct answer. Eric Norberg. Norberg. Just doubled his winnings just by hanging out in the live chat. Look at that. Pretty smart. Moving forward, Glenn Santa, one for the correct answer. And we've got Jim at 2G's, one for the correct answer, one for being in the live chat. Yeah, a lot of doubles and triples. Way to go, guys. Barb Shotness writes, great show tonight, guys. Still enjoying the after show show. She gets one for the correct answer. Barb gets one for the intro video. Barb gets another one for being in the live chat. What? Boom. Another triple. Doesn't even seem fair, does it? Well, we can do. And Mike Lazowski. Mike writes. La-da-dee. Mike writes, hey, I believe this week's Haddam is Morimoto, Michael Mad Chipmunk, basically. And he continues, I could be wrong because, well, I'm a little behind from watching. Wayne shouldn't be so harsh on you about the Iron Chef clues because Bobby Flay is also an Iron Chef from Iron Chef America. I know, right? Now, Wayne, he can't be trusted. Thank you, my brother, Mikey. And finally, we've got Pops. Pops writes, although advertised as being a part of MGM, it must be hard as fuck to find because the website lists walking directions. A, from MGM Grand Front Desk, walk into the casino and at the right turn just past the lobby bar. Continue past concierge towards call box office. Pass Wolfgang Puck and turn right towards the district. Once you enter the district, Morimoto's will be on your right. Yeah, it is actually a little weird getting there, but God bless him, it's worth it. Oh, and of course, Pops has a video. Thank you, Pops.
Hey, kids. Pops here with these nuts. Doing something different tonight.
What up? It's mail time.
Yeah, that's right. I got some mail from the Vegas Video Network. I must be from Scott Whitney. Probably my prize for winning Haddam on the Vegas Video Network's Living in Las Vegas podcast. See what we got here. Scott Whitney's glossy business card.
Nice.
It was autographed on the back. Says congrats, Pops. CD here. Travis Clower's Christmas at My Place CD. Christmas music, just in time for Christmas. That's cool. Oh, and a handwritten note. Dear Pops, congratulations on your fifth Haddam win. Your weekly Haddam videos are anxiously anticipated by the fans. Your continued efforts to promote the Vegas Video Network and the Living in Las Vegas podcast are greatly appreciated. Keep up the good work, your pal Scott. Thanks, Scott. That's pretty cool. Christmas music, just in time for Christmas.
There is almost no chance I would write all that. But creative writing by Pops. Well done. One for the correct answer. One for being in the live chat, and one for the video entry. All right, well done, my friends. Very, very, very good. That's something that Rosie would have wrote on my behalf. Yes, that was Travis's CD. He's like, yeah, Travis, Scott, Travis. Yeah, I go with Travis. Yeah, fair call. $30,000 to make his CD, and it cost me $4.25 to make mine. Okay, here we go. Here's the winner. The winner is... Boink. Fuck. Steve Rhodes from the UK. Congratulations. Steve, you have an opportunity to win either of the Crisp Acoustic CDs as an MP3 file. You're a lucky bastard. Okay, here we go. All right. Here's this week's Have a Drink on Me. Whoop. Okay. Hint number one. The name of this bar is a classification of a woman's best friend. The name of this bar is a classification of a woman's best friend. Hint number two. It's a precious or semi-precious stone. I'm trying to help you people out. And the name is also a precious or semi-precious stone. In other words, it's a precious or semi-precious stone. What is the name for that? And hint number three, it's located in a place that means air in Italian. It's located in a place that means air in Italian. If you know the name of that place, you're going to send the email to haveadrink@vegasvideonetwork.com. Again, haveadrink@vegasvideonetwork.com. Go, everybody. Thanks for hanging out, live chat people. You guys are the best. Hey, if you want to get a question answered, send it to onairq@livinginlv.com. Again, onairq@livinginlv.com. If you want to send us a voicemail, and we'd love for you to do that. We love your voice. You have a lovely singing voice. Go to our webpage at vegasvideonetwork.com. Click the little red tab on the right side, and when you do so, a little window will pop up. You'll click start recording, and because you have a microphone attached to your computer, you'll be able to leave us a voicemail, which is kind of like magic. Hey, we're also on iTunes. Leave us, you know, a 5-star review on both audio and video. That'd be great. We're also on YouTube. Give us a thumbs up and share us with your friends. We're on Roku with over 73,000 accounts installed. Stitcher, TuneIn, Chromecast, Apple, Google, and Chrome TV stuff, Fire TV, Google Play, and of course, the Vegas Video Network. I'm Scott Whitney. Thanks so much for playing along, everybody. You guys are fantastic. We'll see you guys next week on the Living, maybe Living in Las Vegas podcast. Take care. Ticket.